The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
This webinar will begin shortly.
Hello and welcome back to Webinar Week. Today we are joined by Sarita Gamba with her webinar on 7 proven ways to ruin your test automation. Just a reminder again that there's the 10% still off those tickets. It will be available till the end of next month. So hurry then, that is the last discounted ticket prices available. We're also doing the 5 for 4 on groups, and that will also end at the very end of this month. If you have any questions for Sarita, we are going to do a Q&A at the very end of this webinar. Sarita has also asked if you could submit your stories on how you destroyed your own automation or how you've seen others destroy theirs. So without further ado, I will hand over to Sarita.
Okay, perfect. You can hear me?
Yes. Yes.
I'm very happy to hear so many people that want to know how to ruin test automation, because usually it happens per chance. One doesn't really want to do it, and so it's really frustrating. But if you do it on purpose, it can even be fun. What I want to present you is just introduce each method, and of course, people are going to defend against this. I'll explain to you what possible defenses they can have so that you can plan your countermeasures. And I will rate every method so that you can see which are better for you. But before we start, I want to warn you. There is a wiki that's called Test Automation Patterns, and you can find it with testautomationpatterns.org. And this wiki is a collection of solutions that experienced practitioners have already found for issues in test automation. And it helps you find, and it's really dangerous, because if other people find out about this wiki, then you will have trouble destroying test automation. Yeah? So you have to be careful. And this, we offer a diagnostic, and that helps to find the issues that you have in test automation. And we have divided it in process issues, management issues, design and execution. And every issue suggests one or more patterns to solve it. Patterns we have also collected in process, management, design and execution. And so this is very, very dangerous when you are, again, with your colleagues, never talk about it. On the other hand, for you, it is, of course, very helpful, because you can, with these issues and patterns, you can really easily find out what kind of defenses they could put on. And so, of course, if you know it in advance, you can do something about it. So again, for you, it's very important, but never ever tell anybody else, please. Okay, let's start. There are two kinds of methods. The first methods are guillotine methods. So the first step is to develop test automation. You have to do quite a lot because it's no fun to destroy test automation that's not even started. And when you have enough, then you just cut the head off. The other method is called boiled frog methods. You probably have heard that there was an experiment and they put a frog in a big pot full of water. And the frog was swimming happily around. And then they warmed up the water very, very slowly so that the frog didn't really notice it. And when it was not, it did notice it was already cooked. And the same methods can, you can work with test automation. First you develop it and it seems that everything is wonderful and everything works fine and everybody is happy. But then it's more and more effort to keep it running. And at the end, it just becomes shelfware. So let's see, first of all, the guillotine methods. There are three methods here. The first one I called Fire Atlas, then Impossible Goals and Change Tool. Let's start with Fire Atlas. What does it mean? Well, I don't know if you have ever heard in Greek mythology, there was this Titan, it's called Atlas, and he was holding the world on his back. What is that in test automation? Well, in test automation, Atlas would be holding test automation on his back. Actually, Atlas is test automation. He does everything, he knows everything, and if he's not there, test automation will die. So if you eliminate Atlas, what happens? Poof, your test automation is gone. So how do you do it, in fact? Well, depends on you what role you have. If you're a test automator, you develop test automation, but you be careful not to use standards, of course, no documentation or specs, no backup, because nobody else should know something about test automation, only you, no team, of course, and possibly an exotic automation tool, so nobody can use it, or even better, a self-programmed framework. And another very good way that I learned from one of my colleagues, if you have some difficulty to automate some tests, well, you do automate what you can, then you do manually a little bit, and then you automate the rest. It drives anybody crazy that wants to do it when you're not there. And when you have done all that, and of course, as I said, you have to do quite a lot of automation first, then you just leave for a better job. It works like a charm. Now, if you're a manager, you should put Atlas in charge of test automation. Of course, you're not going to demand standard documentation and so on. And so at the end, you can fire Atlas because he or she has not done anything like standards and documentation and good programming methods and so on. So that's also quite easy. Of course, as I said, there are defenses. And if you go in the wiki, you will find an issue called know-how leakage. And this issue suggests quite a few patterns, but I will just tell here the most important. The most important is deputy. So you should, for all people that have important knowledge, you should put a deputy that also can do it so that if they're on vacation or sick or even worse, leave the company, you're not stuck there knowing nothing. And so the test automator in that case, that's how you defend against this defense, yeah, that countermeasure will say, yeah, I will teach somebody all what I know, but I will have time only after milestone X. And of course, after milestone X, there is another milestone and then another milestone, so you never really have time to do that. The manager says, well, right now there's no resource, but I'll keep it in mind. I know it's important. Another important pattern that is suggested is to document the test well. And the test automator say, well, right now I don't have any time. And the manager says, oh, it's not necessary. If you need something, just ask Atlas. Now, another suggested pattern is get training. And the test automator goes to all the trainings and promises that he will explain everything to his colleagues when they come back. Of course, when the that was my telephone. Of course, he doesn't do that because he doesn't have any time. And the manager sends only Atlas to the trainings because to save resources, because Atlas already knows, so he can learn better than somebody that's starting completely new. And finally, there is another pattern suggested, and that's pair up. It's just like in for developers, the pair programming. That's also good for test automation. But the test automator says, well, there's no need. I'm a just one person team, so I cannot pair with anybody else. And that's the same thing that the manager says. It's a good idea, but so actually this method is really good. It's excellent. So now let's go to the next method. And this is a method especially for managers, impossible goals. So for instance, you automate all manual tests or any tester can do automation. Maintenance is not needed for test automation, only for real development. And a test tool is all that's needed to start with test automation. And automated tests should find lots of bugs. I have been working quite a lot with Doris Graham, and she told me once that at a conference she was sitting near a manager and he was describing their test automation, and she was really impressed. They were really doing a good job until he says, but I'm going to kill it. Huh? She said, yeah, because they don't find any bugs. So that manager was really good because he really was destroying a good test automation. I mean, to destroy one that is not really going very well, that's not so much fun, but one that is well, that was a good one. Well, another impossible goals can be that if automated tests pass, it means the software is bug-free or that you get immediate return on investment. I'm sure that lots of people of you listening can list more impossible goals. Maybe you can tell me what you have at the end of the webinar. What are the defenses in this case? Well, there is an issue again in the wiki that's called unrealistic expectations. And what does it suggest? Well, first of all, to set clear goals. If you have clear goals what test automation can or cannot do, of course, you will not have these impossible goals. On the other hand, if you're the manager, well, and you have to decide what the goal is, well, you put your unrealistic expectation is the goal. You're the boss, after all. Another suggested pattern is to do a pilot. And again, the manager said, it's just a waste of time. We just get going with automated. We need all those tests automated. Another one, and this is a dangerous one, is share information. Because share information, if people get to really to understand what's going on and so on, they will be able to counter your actions to destroy test automation. But again, you're a manager, and so if it doesn't fit with your outlook, you just ignore it. And of course, you never send people to conference because people get funny ideas there. Just you tell them, just go on with automation instead of chatting together. So this is also a very excellent method. The next method is change tool. To understand how it works, imagine first that you have a company that is moving stuff all over with trucks. And so everybody in the company has a lot of knowledge with street roads and maps and service station or tank station or service stations. But now imagine that suddenly, for some reason, instead of using trucks and roads, you have to use container ships. So everything that you knew before, you can throw away. You have to start from scratch because now you have to know everything about containers, ports, captains, sailors, and so on. How does this work with test automation? Well, first of all, you have two phases. The first one, use exclusively the tool's functionalities. So for instance, capture replay, the tool's own script language, tool libraries, tool object recognition. Everything is done in the tool with the tool functionality. And then you just change tool. And then you have to start from scratch again. So step one, if you're a test automator, as I said, you use exclusively the tools functionalities. If you're a developer, you implement the application so that the current test tool cannot support it. And that means that you have for step two, there are two options. The first one is just wait it out, because the tool vendor surely is developing a new tool, of course, more modern and wonderful and so on, but coincidentally, probably is not supporting the old tool. And so doesn't compatible to the old tool. And so after they stop supporting it, you will have to switch to a new tool. It's done. You don't have to do anything. Of course, if you don't want to wait it out, you can do something actively. And so if you're a test automator, then you start saying that none of the tests for the new functionalities can be automated, because as you before I told you, the developers take care to see that it's not cannot be driven by the tool. And also that the tests in the tool are too slow, too obscure, whatever. A good test automator can always find some reasons for that. You even get help from marketing, for instance, because they say the current application absolutely needs a modern makeover. And coincidentally, it's not supported by the current tool. Problem, yeah? So this is also a good method. And there are, again, defenses. And the issue is tool dependency. And of course, the possible solution pattern is tool independence. And what does the test automator say? Rewrite everything in that old messy tool? No way. And the manager says, we are not going to change tool. Why should we do this so much fuss? The tool is perfect. So it's a good method. And this time it's not rated excellent, because of course, for a time, you can still use the old tool. And so it doesn't really kill it off as fast as when Atlas leaves the company. On the other hand, when you change to the new tool, you work on it exactly as before, using only exclusively the tool and the tool's functionality. Then you can apply this method again and again and again. So it's not that bad, actually. Okay, these were the guillotine methods. Now let's see what our boiled frog methods are. The first one is primitive programming practices. Then we have manual approach, feigned support, and ever-increasing maintenance. Let's start with the primitive programming practices. What does that mean? Well, if you're a test automator, you automate the test cases using capture replay. Note that in more modern tools, they call it now writing keywords and things like that. But actually, if you look at a little bit deeper, it's the same stuff. Of course, no modularity. Spaghetti code is just the right thing for you. Never reuse code or data. Documentation is boring, so you don't do it. Use crazy names. That's a method that I developed myself when I started programming. It was not for test automation, of course, but it works for test automation also. It was my very first program. I was in Italy, and I had lots of fun because I put all the variables with names like pizza, mozzarella, tomato, and so on. And I thought it was really cool. Until a couple of months later, I had to do something to this program. And I found out that it wasn't a very cool idea after all. So but of course, if you do that, then somebody else has to do something to your script. Well, that of course works like a charm. Another possibility is that's one that a colleague of mine was using to write giant scripts. That one script tests everything. It's also a very good idea. If you're a manager, you just tell people everybody should automate you and make sure that you don't have time for refactoring. You can play around later. The problem is that, especially when you're starting, you will not be able to write the scripts or whatever as good as you would when you're experienced. It's normal. So actually, one does need some time later, because when you look at the scripts you have written in the beginning, you say, oh God, did I do that? And so it would be a very good idea to scrap them and write them again. But of course, as a manager, you want to destroy test automation. That's exactly what you're not allowed to do. Again, there is an issue in the wiki that describes this problem. It's called brittle scripts, and it suggests good programming practices. So for instance, design for reuse. If you reuse stuff, it means that you have the information only in one place. If something in that point changes, you have to change it only in one place. And so, of course, maintenance is much easier and much more successful. Keep it simple. Don't write these giant scripts. Set standards so that everybody speaks the same language and you can find things because you know where they should be and so on. Independent test cases, that's also important because usually a manual tester, can test things that build on each other. So maybe you create something and you change it and you delete it and so on. But that's not a very good idea for test automation because if one of the test cases that just fails before the ones, then all that next ones cannot run, so you don't know if they were good or not. And of course, data-driven testing or keyword-driven testing is a very good idea. If you go to the wiki, you can see a little better explanation what it is. So if you're the test automator, what do you say? Mañana. You know what mañana means? Well, mañana is Spanish and it means tomorrow. But tomorrow in Spanish means never. And the manager says, oh, automate all test cases. What's all this stuff about programming practices and so on? So this is also quite an excellent method. The next method is the manual approach. So this is a little bit what I've already said, long chains of tests that depend on each other, or one test is built with everything, complicated GUI workarounds instead of going in the database. You compare results also. Too complicated, do as my colleague, do it manually. It was very successful because she did this and nobody knew about it because she was also doing all the stuff in the test and controlling them and so on. And then one day she goes on vacation for 2 weeks. In Germany we have more vacations. And so I was supposed to run her test. And so I started the test. And next day it was stopped. I think the second test was already stopped. And no, why and so on. And then I saw, and it took days to find out, that there was some pop-up and you had to just click on it, but it was not automated. So she usually had two or three screens on her desk. And when she was working on something, she was always keeping an eye on that, on the automation. And if she saw that this pop-up was coming, she just clicked it off and then it went on. But she never told anything about it, nobody. And so, of course, nothing was wrong. That's a very good method, in fact. So the manager says every manual test has to be automated and refactoring is needed only for development and not for test automation. Again, we have an issue for that. It's called manual mimicry. And it suggests to think out of the box. That means that don't just execute the automated tests as they are executed manually, but think how to use the possibilities that automation offers you. And you can, the countermeasure is if you're a tester to write an understandable test specification, because if the automator doesn't really understand what the test is doing, he cannot do anything else, he must do exactly as described. And so you cannot use more intelligent methods. And if you're a manager, you say tests must be automated exactly as is because they have been specified by our best tester. And so you have to do it exactly as that as it is specified. So this is also very excellent, quite an excellent method. Next method, this is also again, one method is very perfect for managers. and I know it very well because my own manager was using it all the time. What does it mean? Well, you promise 100% support, but you never really give it. And you never you plan support for test automation, so you don't get, as automator, you don't get support from testers, from if you need some special knowledge from the database people or web or whatever, they don't have time, it's not planned. You don't have the resources, so if you need a machine or so, it's not there. And of course, test automators work only part-time on automation. And if you ever go to the manager and ask for help, he says, yeah, I'm supporting you 100%, but he never has time or what. So again, the issue is inadequate support, and the suggested pattern is management support. As I said, the manager should always say, I'm supporting you 120%. No, 100 is not enough. But of course, in his pocket, he has a list of all possible excuses why just now it doesn't work. Yeah, this is also a very excellent method. Absolutely, I have been trying to fix it myself quite a long time with my boss. Best method, ever increasing maintenance. What does that mean? Well, if you're a developer, you can do changes in the application to be tested that just disrupt automation. For instance, if you are in .NET and you just change the object hierarchy, that then the automation tool doesn't recognize the objects anymore. Then you use GUI components that are not supported by the tool. Another interesting thing is we had, for instance, we were controlling if the test had passed looking in the logs. Now, if you change the text in the logs, or even better, you change the sequence of the logs, then of course nothing fits anymore. Even if the test actually passed, you always get red. You can change the database, of course, in the qualifiers. And of course, never ever tell people, especially automators, that you have changed something. It's much more fun to see how they are working day and night to find out why all their tests are getting red. If you're a test automator, of course, you can use the method that we have already seen before. Avoid using variables, never reuse scripts or data. Then define the GUI object to be driven with pixels or runtime units, so because that changes every time. So that makes it much more difficult to keep the tests running. Give non-descriptive names to objects, like my pizza and mozzarella are fine. And never save the scripts or data so that you have to recreate them all the time. And again, there is a count defenses, an issue called hard to automate. And it suggests a pattern that's called testable software. And this pattern suggests other patterns. The first one is to ask for help, because if you don't know something, you should just not start brooding there all the time, but try to find out who knows it and then immediately just ask. Share information is another good thing. We have already seen it, because you can tell what is disturbing the test automation and ask people what they are doing, so you can connect to them and find a solution for the problem. And do a pilot, of course, again, if you try to do something in small, it is better than to first construct everything and then find out that it doesn't work. But as a developer, you can see, just ignore the needs of test automation. You're working for the customer, after all, so you don't have time or don't really interested in being helping the test automation. And the test automator, of course, you say, as soon as I have time, it's again the next time, then you will do some refactoring. This next time is manana, as I said before. So again, this is an excellent method. Now, the best way to do this is to mix the methods. There are thousands of combinations, of course, 7. And for instance, you can say what I show here, you have primitive programming methods with a manual approach, and you get an ever increasing maintenance. Or else you can have, this is for managers, faint support with impossible goals. And the one I like best is this one. You have Atlas that is using primitive programming methods with a manual approach to try to achieve impossible goals, and in this way gets ever increasing maintenance. Then he changes tool, and then he quits and goes to another company because now he has learned everything that was important for him. So you see, probably you can find, as I asked Piotna, probably you have other methods that you have seen used or used yourself to destroy test automation, and I would really like to hear about them because then I can put me in the, in this talk more. But the ones I have, or the first one is Fire Atlas, so depend on one person. Impossible Goals, that's, as I said, the management favorite. Change Tool, the tool drives the automated test work. Limited foreign practice, you don't have standard documentation and so on. Manual approach, automate manual tests as is. Feigned support, promise but never deliver. Ever increasing maintenance, build technical debt. And as I said, I'm sure that you can show me more interesting methods. But anyway, I wish you success in applying these methods. And here you have also my email address. So if you need help, you just write to me. I will be very glad. I will have fun helping you. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Sureta. Thank you for your presentation. So just to remind everyone again that there still is that time to submit your questions. Please do. Also, submit your stories on test automation, how they failed, how you've seen others fail. There is one webinar left in our series. It's tomorrow with Michael Bolton, Logic of Verification. You can sign up for that webinar over there on the Huddle site. So we'll get to some questions. Sureta, how would you ignore the build, test, deploy? Would you ignore the build, test, deploy pipeline?
Well, I would try. The problem is, of course, you cannot do it so officially. You have to try to. That's the idea, that you destroy it, but you are not going to tell them that you're doing it. So, yes. In the beginning, maybe there would be some problems that doesn't work and this and that. So you have to decide from time to time, of course. So now it's a little bit, what do you mean in that case?
Okay. Do you keep tests separate and distinct from development?
Actually, if you separate it, it's better, it's easier to ruin. And so actually we have a pattern that's called whole team approach that tells you that good test automation is done with the whole team. So but as I say, if you want to destroy it, it's better if it's separated.
Okay. Hi, my team are going to find and start up test automation for the first time. Are there anything you think general that we need to be aware of?
Yes, if you're starting, well, that's just what the wiki is there for, because there are lots of information. There is one issue, it's called no previous test automation, and it tells you exactly what you should do to begin with. And I must say that I started test automation, I was a developer first, and I had no idea of testing, not only of test automation. So I had to really learn from the very beginning. And so I fell in every hole that was there. I think I invented a lot myself, and I invented a lot of wheels, which is not necessary because people have already had most of the problems that one gets at the beginning. And that's the reason for the patterns. I mean, a pattern is something that has been used again and again, and it works. And the patterns that we have collected are not the same as the patterns for development. Usually there are some coding problem, and then you get some code snippets that solve that problem, and you just have to use them. Eventually, you have to translate them to your own development system, but you get the code. In this case, you cannot, because the problems are more in system level test automation, can be more generalized. I mean, if you have a management problem, the solution will be very different, even if it's the same pattern. If you are in a very big company like Siemens in Germany, or in a small company like I was working with 100 people, even if it's the same pattern. So what the pattern suggests usually is just that you to try something and to see if it works in your context. It has worked before, so you don't have to invent all the wheels. You can use the ones that are already there and build up from there. So actually, if you're starting with test automation, the first thing to do, go to the wiki and see what it tells, because it will avoid lots of problems that otherwise, without knowing, you will go to make, you will be making.
Okay. Is there such a thing as 100% test coverage?
I don't think so, because it's a question of how do you define it. I mean, there are so many definitions of coverage that I would say no, but I don't know if I'm alone in this idea or not.
Okay. What are your favorite test tools?
Well, I cannot say favorite, because I in the company where we were using a couple of vendor tools, also not the open code ones, and so I know those, and I think in the meantime there are better ones, but so I cannot really suggest which one. It depends also on what you're doing, so depends on your application. What we suggest is when you are trying to find the tool, is to eventually to find, let's say, two that look good, and then just to try to automate the same stuff in both tools and look where you are better. It's also important to use tools that you have people that know them, because otherwise, for instance, in our case, nobody knew about it, so we had to learn it. Okay, you get training and so on, but it's not the same thing as when you already know it. So if you use tools that are widely known, it's easier to find people that can use it and can teach you and so on. But as I said, it depends. I was once in a tutorial with Lee Copeland, and every question that one told him, if the answer was always, it depends. And I think it was a very good answer. And in this case, I would also say it depends.
Okay. What do you think about using the front-end testing tool and expanding it to test back-end, and to make that tool more powerful, that it will be able to run another test from the test case body?
I don't really understand what that means.
Okay.
What do you mean with test and
I'm just...
I don't know who put this question, but you have seen my email address at the end.
Yeah.
Send me a mail and explain exactly what you want, what you mean, and then I can answer.
Okay, perfect. A story here is dumbing down test checks so that you don't have to investigate an issue. This leads to bugs being ignored by the automation, showing passing tests and issues that could have been caught getting into production.
Ah, that's a good one. Okay, thanks.
How do you write a specific to product framework and still keep it tool independent?
Well, we did that. You cannot do it completely tool independent, of course. But what we did was, we had different, you call it abstraction level. So we had a level with the very low level scripts that was written in the tool, of course. But then we had the framework that outside of the tool that had a kind of meta language that was calling the very technical stuff in the tool. So we had keywords for stuff like edit, write something in an edit field, or click a button, or things like that, really very technical. But then we had outside with the framework, we were using this stuff, but all the logic of the application was outside of the tool. It was just using this technical stuff in the tool, so that we did change tool at some time. It wasn't that terrible because we only had to change the this technical layer. And then what we also used that was also important, we had all the objects defined in an object map repository. It's all called over different, but it tells the tool how to recognize some object, and we gave it some standardized names. So the scripts that we were writing were using the standardized names, and later we could, when we changed the tool, we had to tell the new tool the names, because tools otherwise use some internal names that don't are always different. So we had all the tools, the old one and the new tool, are using the same names, and in this way we didn't have to change the scripts because the names were the same. The keywords that were the technical keywords that were called also had the same name. So we only had to change this really deep technical layer, and all the rest was just as before.
Okay. Is there a generic way of designing tests so that they can be transformed between different test tools easily?
Well, that's what we did. I don't know if there are other methods, but you usually, what people say is to use this so-called domain-driven language, that you have some keywords that describe what your application is doing. So of course, it's different if you're a bank or an insurance or manufacturer, whatever. And these and the testers use this domain language to write the tests. But so what they don't even know what inside of each of the keywords. And of course, you have to keep these keywords also at least as much as possible outside of the tool, so that you just have to change the most technical stuff. If you write these keywords also in the tool, of course, when you change tool, you have to write everything again. That's the problem. So the trick is to write in the tool really only what and you cannot do otherwise. Otherwise, you cannot use the tool. So you will have some work to do if you change tool, but you have to keep it at the minimum.
Is it best to test the front end through the browser, or can it be helpful to write tests to directly call front end JavaScript methods?
I think both ways are good. I mean, I think one should probably use both of them.
Okay. Who's better at destroying test automation? Developer who's first time testing, or tester who's newbie with automation?
I think both are good because they have different methods, of course. But I still think that the best are the managers.
Yeah. Okay, so last question, Sarada. Do you have any good alibis to use if discovered applying some of the disruptive actions you covered to ruin test automation?
Wait a minute. You say it another time slowly. Yeah.
Do you have any good alibis to use if you're alibis, like a cover-up? Do you have any good cover-ups to use if discovered applying some of the disruptive actions you've covered to ruin automation?
Well, no, I don't. Well, as I said, I don't really know, because actually, of course, I have done this talk, so on the funny side. But usually people do this without really realizing that they're destroying test automation. So they don't really need an alibi because they're innocent. They're doing they think they're doing it wonderfully.
That's great. I think this person is just looking for an excuse to get out of his bad work.
Well, then you can use probably the Atlas method and just leave the company.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Sarada, for your time today. Of course, I will hand over all these questions to you. You will get them. You will get them all in an email. People can respond to you. This webinar will be recorded, so that slide with Soretta's information will be up on the Huddle site. So please do get in contact with Soretta if you have any more questions. And she does want to hear your stories on ruining test automation or how you've seen it ruined. Yeah. Soretta, thank you so much again for your time today, and we can speak soon.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Goodbye.